Hello and welcome to the Alabama Public Health Training Network. We're glad you could join us today for this program, Nuclear Power Plant Safety and the Public Health Response. Our objectives today are to describe the general aspects of a nuclear power plant malfunction. We'll discuss potential health effects of a nuclear power plant accident. We'll describe three protective actions measures. And we'll discuss the general characteristics of population monitoring after a nuclear power plant accident. As a reminder, throughout the program, you will see our 800 number and our email address up on the screen. Call or email any questions or comments you might have. Our panel of experts will certainly be happy to answer your questions. The handout, sign-in sheet, and evaluation for this program are all available online. Don't forget, you will need to register for this program in order to access those materials. Nurses, those of you watching for continuing education credit, I am required to tell you the following information. In order to receive credit for this training, you must watch the entire program and upload your own CE to the Board of Nursing. While content may continue to be relevant, continuing education credit will only be awarded for 2 years from today's date, which is April 13th, 2012. Today's broadcast is produced by the South Central Preparedness and Emergency Response Learning Center and in collaboration with the Alabama Department of Public Health. Funding for the center does come from the CDC. If you'd like more information on the center, you can visit our website, which is listed there on your screen. Time now to introduce our faculty presenters. First, over here on the far side, we have Dr. Ziad Kazi, and next to him, we have Dr. Robert Whitcomb, both with the CDC. Gentlemen, we're certainly glad to have you here, and I think we have already established before the program started that it is okay if I call you Kazi and if I address you as Bob, correct?
Yes, fine.
Wonderful. Gentlemen, we're so glad that you could be here to talk about this topic. Obviously, it's one of great concern to a lot of folks because I think a lot of it is the unknowns surrounding nuclear power plants and what can happen and what to do in an accident response. So I guess the obvious is to start with the basics. And how many nuclear power plants do we have here in the United States? How do they work? How do they make power?
Okay. Well, in the U.S., we have about 64 plants constituting about 104 reactors. And in many of these plant situations, we have more than one reactor per plant. But basically, about 20% of our electrical power generation in the U.S. is produced by nuclear power. Compare and contrast that with other countries. France, for example, gets about 80% of their power from nuclear power generation. So nuclear power is worldwide. In fact, there is a rebirth of nuclear power in our country as there is in the world. Some of the existing facilities in our country are actually going to put more than two per site. So in fact, in Georgia and a few other states, they're actually building new reactors or beginning construction on new reactors as we speak. So let's talk a little bit about the two different reactor designs that are in place in the U.S. and abroad. Basically, there are two types. There's a boiling water reactor type and a pressurized water reactor type. On the screen, you can view the pictorial, if you will, of a boiling water reactor. And what you have basically is in the core of the reactor, there is uranium fuel rods that are producing the fission, generating the heat, and that heat being transferred to water, which in turn is turned to steam. In a boiling water reactor, we allow the water to boil, producing the steam inside that loop system. That steam is then transferred via pipes to the turbines, which are turning by way of the steam being produced around them, turning the generator, producing electricity, which is sent out on the grid, powering homes, businesses, and the like. That water, once it passes through the turbines, has to be condensed back into water and then brought back through the process again. Compare and contrast that, if you will, to the pressurized water reactor. In this system, this type, we have the reactor core producing the heat, generating high temperatures, but we keep this primary loop under pressure. If you pressurize water as it heats, you can actually heat it above the boiling point, being a superheated water, and then that can be transferred into steam at the steam generator location. So you have a secondary loop of water going through the steam generators being where the steam is being produced, thereby going through the same loop again, to the turbines, turning the generators, producing electricity, and then condensing again. But the pressurized water reactors are those two-loop systems that keep it under significant pressure.
Okay, obviously a lot going on with the reactors, and I'm sure there are plenty of safety measures in place to kind of keep people safe in case an accident does happen. So talk about those a little bit.
Well, if you take a look inside the reactor itself, you look at the fuel rod first. The fuel itself is in pelletized form. It's a very high compact uranium fuel pellet. Those are stacked in line inside fuel rods, and those fuel rods are stacked in assemblies, and those make up the reactor core. So the primary or the first barrier is the fuel pellet itself. It's in such hard ceramic-like form that, reduces the amount of fission products that come out as the fission occurs inside the pellet. The second barrier is the fuel cladding. It's a zirconium aluminum alloy. They call it zircaloy, just to, as a quick way of saying it. So this zirconium aluminum alloy is the second protective barrier. And then you have the reactor vessel itself surrounding all the fuel assemblies. And then a huge concrete containment structure around that whole system. Mm-hmm. So those are four barriers that are safety barriers put in place to prevent releases, but also to contain the heat and the other activities generated inside the reactor.
Well, even with all those barriers, it's obvious that things can sometimes go wrong. Obviously, the most recent incident of a nuclear power plant accident was in Japan.
Yes.
Can you talk about that incident for us?
Yes. You know, despite the best safety measures that took place in Japan, what we saw occurring was an earthquake first off the coast of Japan, and it just occurred just off the coast of the Fukushima nuclear power station. That earthquake itself set in a chain of events that all nuclear power plant safety systems have, that is to stop the reactor from operating on any seismic activity. So all the reactors on that felt that vibration did stop. The control rods were put in place, stopping the fission reaction. However, what is also critical in that whole point is once you stop the reactor from producing the significant heat that produces the steam, producing the power generation, there's a lot of decay heat that still occurs after the plant is shut down. Most of this is by the heavy number of fission products that are still in the reactor core as it had been going through its life cycle of fissioning. That's what we call decay heat, and it produces enough heat that you have to keep water cooling throughout the system even after shutdown so you prevent any problems. What subsequently occurred after the earthquake, which tripped the reactors and caused them to go offline, is the tsunami. It was larger than expected. It went over the tsunami barriers and pretty much inundated the entire plant. What that caused was a chain of events where backup systems could not operate. There are significant emergency core cooling systems that were in place that can run off a battery if you lose off-site power, which they did. Those batteries were inundated with the surge of water, and then also the diesel fuel source. There's a diesel, pretty much diesel engine the size of a freight train engine that is basically a backup power system if you lose off-site power. Those diesel generators were also inundated, plus the fuel itself, the diesel generator fuel, was in an area that was affected by the tsunami. That chain of events caused the problem we saw at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power station. In the screenshot that folks see, it's what we have here is the auxiliary buildings that exhibited the explosions. And let me talk a little bit about how that occurred. As the cooling systems failed and the heat from the core rose extremely high, water tables or water levels went down in the reactor core, the zirconium aluminum alloy, when it gets into high pressure, high heat situations at very high temperatures, you can actually get hydrogen buildup inside the reactor containment. That hydrogen, as we know, is a very volatile gas, so any spark, any static electricity could set that off. So the primary concern was once the emergency core cooling systems were lost, the heat rose, hydrogen was building up, the plant operators were really scrambling to keep the reactors cool, but also at the same time vent that explosive hydrogen out of the reactor core. What they did was they vented it outside the containment. Remember that fourth barrier I discussed earlier? They wanted to take it out of the reactor core into an auxiliary building outside that concrete shell. It did, they were able to at least vent one of the reactors, but two of the buildings, the auxiliary buildings, not the primary containment, actually exploded because of an ignition source with that hydrogen buildup. So that's what we saw occurring at Fukushima. So it wasn't the reactors blowing up, it was hydrogen, because the reactors were going into a situation that was degrading, that's what caused the auxiliary building outside of those reactor, at least the primary barriers, from degrading. But with that, because of the high heat generation, because there were some degraded systems, they were using seawater as coolant because they weren't getting their primary water, because most of the water that's used inside a nuclear facility is very pristine. They want to take all contaminants out so they don't go through the reactor, they don't get activated inside the reactor, so you don't have to deal with radioactivity as much. So once we started seeing seawater being used, we knew it had degraded to a situation where they were drawing straws to try to keep those reactors cool. Mm-hmm. But subsequently, we had releases of some fission products. Mm-hmm. The ones that we primarily saw were iodine and cesium. Those are very volatile. They escape very easily into the environment. So those were the first nuclides that we saw released from those facilities.
Okay. Compare this accident last year to the other accidents folks are familiar with, Chernobyl and even Three Mile Island. How do they all compare on a scale? Or can you compare them on a scale?
Well, that was interesting. When we were responding from the U.S. Mm-hmm. at the CDC's Emergency Operations Center, even though it wasn't a incident at or within the U.S. borders, there was still a significant concern. The CDC director asked us how serious this accident was, and with little information, we could just judge on the International Nuclear Event Scale that we were looking at an accident that was somewhere between Three Mile Island and Chernobyl. We knew at the time it was not going to be as bad as Chernobyl because the reactors designed with those four barrier systems were so protective. Mm-hmm. The one in Chernobyl was basically a graphite reactor with inside of a warehouse type facility rather than having those containment structures. Mm-hmm. So we knew it wasn't going to be as bad as Chernobyl as far as releases go. Mm-hmm. But we knew that it was going to probably be a little bit more than Three Mile Island, because Three Mile Island was not significant at all in regards to radioactive material release, but we did see radioactive material release in measurable quantities from Fukushima. Mm-hmm. Even though the Fukushima nuclear power station exhibited a level 7 on the international scale, which is similar to Chernobyl, mm-hmm. the releases from Fukushima were not nearly as high.
Okay. So when those releases happen, what happens when people get exposed? Do they just have to be near it, by it? How does that work with the exposure from the releases?
We worry about a number of things with radiation, primary routes of exposure. How might people be exposed to this? If I stand next to a radioactive material, I can be exposed by the radiation emissions from those materials. But for at least incidents like this where you have releases occurring at the plant, we have a number of pathways of exposure we worry about. Mm-hmm. Primarily, inhalation is one pathway where people can breathe in material as it's released to the atmosphere and gets to them by the winds and by the meteorology going on in the area. But more importantly, and even what we saw here in the U.S., because our detection systems are so high, we were able to detect in the U.S. mm-hmm. what we call fallout from Fukushima, iodine and some cesium, because it travels very far with the winds. The pathways we worried about here in the U.S. were primarily fallout from the cloud, falling on the grass, being eaten by the cows. The cows take it up into their milk, express it in the milk, and then infants and people and others drinking that milk. So that's an ingestion route mm-hmm. where it eventually gets into the food source, but it could fall on sources of water. And also fall on other vegetable crops. Mm-hmm. So we always are worried about those pathways of exposure, and we can talk later on about some interdiction-type protective measures we can take if that does happen.
Okay. Obviously, these pathways of exposure, and Kazi, I'm going to bring you in now since you are the medical doctor. What happens to people when they cross these exposures? What are the effects? How do they get sick after these exposures? Because we all know it's dangerous.
That's a great question. The medical effects that can occur will depend on where the actual location is. Mm-hmm. And it's important to differentiate two different locations. You know, people that are actually in the nuclear power plant, whether they are nuclear power plant workers mm-hmm. who are trying to mitigate the problem, or whether it is a emergency worker, firefighter like we saw in Chernobyl, or a paramedic coming in there to rescue injured individuals, those people are subjected to a different hazard, a higher level of radiation exposure. And these people you can expect potentially, if the dose is high enough, acute illness. In addition to the physical hazards that are present in that environment where explosions can occur, heat can be released, these acute illness were seen in Chernobyl significantly, in addition to long-term medical effects as well to these emergency workers. Now, these acute injuries that can occur, we call them deterministic injuries. What does that mean? That means injuries that obey a certain threshold dose beyond which you will get the illness, below which you don't get the illness. And a great example would be acute radiation syndrome or cutaneous radiation syndrome. All of these are deterministic effects of radiation exposure that are primarily an issue inside the nuclear power plant. Now, we saw those in Chernobyl. We didn't see anything significant in Fukushima, and whether that's because the workers were protected from this exposure or they were not present in these areas of high radiation levels. And we only saw one incident that I will discuss in a little bit later in the presentation from a worker standpoint. Now, outside the nuclear power plant, now you talk about the communities and people living around the nuclear power plant at 10 miles, 20 miles, 50 miles. These communities can be exposed to radiation through contamination and will not develop any acute illness. So we do not expect any acute illness in these surrounding communities. The concerns there are more long-term medical effects, primarily cancer. And that's where the concern from Chernobyl and the rise in thyroid cancer that we will discuss in a little bit. The other long-term effects that people are concerned about are effects on babies that are in the womb and they can be born after the accident. We did not see that in Chernobyl, but that is a concern. Another concern that we have never seen in a nuclear power plant accident, but still sometimes comes up in discussion, is effects of unborn or unconceived children, which we call hereditary effects or genetic effects of radiation. The surrounding communities in Chernobyl were contaminated with radioactive iodine, and did develop more thyroid cancer than the usual baseline occurrence of the disease in the community. In Fukushima, we don't think that's going to be the case. Currently, there are some epidemiological studies that are getting started or already started, looking at the health effects on the community. And the current understanding and opinion is that the level of radiation exposure or contamination that occurred in this public is not going to be resulting in any significant long-term effects like thyroid cancer or other type of cancers. The last but not least, the very important medical effect that can occur from a nuclear power plant accident is the mental health effects. And people are scared, and I think that a program like this can help them appease their concerns and feel more confident in the safety mechanisms that are in place and feel confident about their health if such an accident occur in the future.
I would think the mental aspect of health is one that often gets looked over, because I think people are so worried about exposure and what it's going to do to them physically, you know, as you mentioned with the cancers and, you know, some of the other illnesses that can happen from the exposure. I think people forget about the mental aspect of it, just the fear of what could happen and just experiencing that whole nuclear power plant accident, being around there when it happened. So I think that's an interesting point.
Absolutely. If I can you know, expand on that a little bit, the Centers for Disease Control has developed material that are very useful with regards to psychological effects of radiation disasters, and using witnesses from Three Mile Island and people involved in the Goiânia incident in Brazil, which was not a nuclear power plant incident, but still a radiation disaster. The mental health issues are unique because the public is concerned of a long-term consequence. They can't really tell for sure if they're going to develop that illness or not. There's a lot of media emphasis on the fear from radiation, and so there's a lot of psychological element there that plays into this. And I think that's unique in radiological disasters. And I think mental health should be an integral part of any response to a disaster surrounding a nuclear power plant.
Right. And the more you know about things that can happen to you when this type of thing happens, the better off you're going to be mentally, physically, that kind of thing. So do you want to talk a little bit more about some of these diseases that can occur?
Sure, certainly.
This type of accident happens. I mean, I think we've talked a little bit about how you can get contaminated, you know, different routes and everything. So then what happens once you are contaminated? You're one of the unfortunate ones that have been contaminated. What can folks expect then?
Well, I think Bob discussed that a little bit, how the contamination can be primarily through inhalation. People inhale the gaseous radioactive material, or they can ingest it in water or milk or other type of food products. Mm-hmm. That makes an external environmental contamination internalized into the body. And once you have these radioactive materials, for example, iodine, mm-hmm. would go and concentrate in the thyroid. And when it concentrates in the thyroid gland, it will emit radiation there. Mm-hmm. Radiation can, ionizing radiation, can actually damage cells, mm-hmm. and can also damage the genetic material inside the cells. Mm-hmm. That can lead to cell damage, of course, and the body is able to repair that damage. However, if the body is overwhelmed because of the large amount of cells that are injured, then the body may fall behind, and then you'll develop a mutation that can lead to cancer. Mm-hmm. And that is a random occurrence that we cannot really necessarily predict the same way we predict the acute illness from radiation exposure. Okay. The radioactive iodine is particular because it actually concentrates like non-radioactive iodine, mm-hmm. in the thyroid gland in order to produce thyroid hormone. Mm-hmm. So naturally the damage you will see will be in the thyroid gland. Mm-hmm. And the thyroid gland can have thyroid diseases, but primarily the issue here is thyroid cancer. Okay. We've seen in Chernobyl, up till now, mm-hmm. since 1986, about 6,000 cases that have been linked to that Chernobyl accident. Now, it is true that maybe the increase in screening or awareness looking for the thyroid cancer may have contributed some to the increase in numbers, mm-hmm. but certainly there are 6,000 cases that are believed to be caused in part by the Chernobyl accident. Mm-hmm. These cases, they've had some unique characteristics. For example, the most common type of thyroid cancer noted in Chernobyl was of the follicular papillary type, mm-hmm. and the latency period from the date of the Chernobyl accidental release to the manifestation of the cancer was relatively short, mm-hmm. for thyroid cancer. It was about 4 years, I believe, in the shortest latency. Okay. The good news about this thyroid cancer is that the mortality is low. So the mortality at 30 years from that thyroid cancer was about 1%.
Oh, wow.
Now, unfortunately, there's a risk of recurrence. Mm-hmm. That recurrence can be up to 30%, and it varies. There's a range of values out there, but up to 30%. Okay. So that was the primary consequence of Chernobyl. Mm-hmm. The Fukushima plant, I want to just reiterate that the current expert opinion is that doses were not high enough to cause that, mm-hmm. and they do not believe that they will see a significant rise of thyroid cancer above baseline.
Okay.
They are still going to do the studies, mm-hmm. To look at that. And if anything, it will actually reassure the public, mm-hmm. that their health, that they are safe. Radioactive iodine, mm-hmm. will go to the thyroid gland. Other radionuclides can go somewhere else.
Okay.
So if you are contaminated internally with cesium, mm-hmm. they will not go to the thyroid gland and may cause other type of tumors.
Okay.
So there's also a concern of other types of tumors occurring, mm-hmm. that we did not see actually in Chernobyl, but of course the concern is there. Mm-hmm. Leukemias are always a concern. We did not see any rise in leukemia in the public health community, in the community around Chernobyl. However, we did see some increase in leukemia in the nuclear power plant workers or inside the nuclear power plant,
okay.
who we already discussed, mm-hmm. can be affected by acute illness as well as potential long-term effects.
Right.
With that, I think it's important to remember that educating the public about these health effects is very important, and I really thank you for your question.
Sure. Sure, and I kind of want to ask you, you know, we're touching a lot on the cancers, and forgive me if you're going to go into this shortly. You know, cancer is a very serious side effect. Are there some less serious side effects that people should be aware of if they're exposed, whether external, you know, outside the power plant, you know, they live in a zone near the power plant, or in the power plant, some less serious symptoms they should be aware of? Or?
Well, we mentioned thyroid disease that mm-hmm. can occur that we have not really seen. Mm-hmm. I want to also reemphasize that, add that the thyroid cancer that we're seeing in Chernobyl were primarily in patients that were children at the time of the mm-hmm. accident. And that's very important to remember as well, because children's thyroid glands are very active mm-hmm. and they're able to uptake more iodine than adults.
Okay.
For example, someone as old as Bob here probably doesn't uptake much thyroid, much radioiodine.
Right.
So these children and even babies that were in the womb at the time of the accident, mm-hmm. this is where the incidence of thyroid cancer was highest
okay.
in these mm-hmm. populations. Pregnant women, of course, are important to protect because they carry mm-hmm. a developing fetus.
Right.
Whose thyroid is active very early in the gestation. Mm-hmm. Pregnant women as well are iodine deficient because of their hypermetabolic state and can uptake some more radioactive iodine.
Mm-hmm.
The unique aspect also in Chernobyl was that kids drank a lot of milk there,
mm-hmm.
unlike in Japan. The other thing to remember is that around Chernobyl, the diet was not supplemented with iodine. So many people were iodine deficient,
mm-hmm.
which is not the case in the U.S., where we supplement our diet with iodine.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, you should not feel reassured completely that iodine deficiency is not a problem in the U.S. Actually, I don't think we are close to 100% iodine sufficiency status in
right.
the U.S., and I think educating the public about that is also very important
mm-hmm.
because iodine sufficiency in your diet can protect you as well
mm-hmm.
from radioiodine uptake.
Okay, very good. And obviously, you know, it goes beyond the public. You know, you have to educate your workers in the nuclear power plants too. So what about them when they are close to a reactor when accidents happen? What happens to them? Because they're obviously much closer to the source of the accident than folks who are living outside of the plant. So
absolutely. And these are professionals that, if they are actually nuclear power plant workers, they've been working
mm-hmm.
in this environment on a day-to-day basis. And they're professionals in protecting themselves and not entering an area that is where the exposure is high or hazardous to them.
Mm-hmm.
They can divide up their teams into shifts so that they decrease the duration of exposure.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, in Fukushima, we did see three workers that apparently stepped into a pond of water that was hot,
mm-hmm.
hot meaning temperature hot,
mm-hmm.
as well as potentially radioactive. Now, unfortunately, we don't have a lot of details on the medical condition of these workers.
Mm-hmm.
It was all reported in the media. There was a report of burns in these workers, and I imagine they were evaluated. I imagine their clothes being removed. I imagine their body being surveyed for radiation contamination with the material.
Mm-hmm.
And if there was any contamination, I imagine that they've cleaned it off and then evaluated them appropriately for medical effects.
Right.
Unfortunately, that information is not available.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on the other hand, in Chernobyl, we know more about the health effects, the acute health effects on the workers.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the reports out there that discusses that cites over 100 workers out of 600 that were present on that morning developing acute radiation illness,
mm-hmm.
what we call acute radiation syndrome. And out of these 130, about 28, if I remember correctly, died.
Wow.
Within a few months from the acute radiation syndrome. Acute radiation syndrome, or the acute radiation injury, is what you can see inside the nuclear power plant
mm-hmm.
that we already mentioned being a deterministic disease
mm-hmm.
Where you get the disease if you cross a certain threshold.
Mm-hmm.
And then the syndrome that is in question here is divided into several sub-syndromes.
Mm-hmm.
depending on the dose that the worker is exposed to, the higher the dose, the more of these sub-syndromes you get. Mm-hmm. If you have a certain dose, then you can get the bone marrow syndrome, also called the hematopoietic syndrome. Mm-hmm. A higher dose, you add to that the gastrointestinal syndrome. If you get even a higher dose, you add to that the cardiovascular or neurologic or neurovascular syndrome. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the gastrointestinal, cardiovascular, neurologic sub-syndromes have a very poor prognosis, and many of these patients will not survive and require palliative care instead. Mm-hmm. Now, that offers an opportunity to really care intensively to the bone marrow syndrome patients. Mm-hmm. These patients can survive. These patients need to be identified, and these patients need to receive our intensive care that's available. How do we do that? How do we predict what patient will develop that bone marrow syndrome? That's a challenge. Mm-hmm. And you have to add to it as well other injuries that could have occurred, physical injuries, mm-hmm. trauma injuries, that burns that could have occurred to this individual.
Right.
Luckily for us, though, there's a prodrome for this syndrome mm-hmm. that can give us some information if present.
Okay. So what are then some of the things that doctors should look for if these emergency responders, plant workers, are going to become ill after, you know, something like this happens?
Well, the prodrome, as I said, is the easiest thing to look for because mm-hmm. it relies on signs and symptoms. And the most reliable one would be vomiting mm-hmm. because vomiting within 4 hours, and I'm quoting here the Radiation Emergency Assistance Center training site, REACTS, which as well as the REM website, the Radiation Emergency Medical Management website, they both list 4 hours. So if you vomit within 4 hours after radiation exposure, then you are at risk of developing significant disease, meaning your exposure to radiation was significant. Mm-hmm. Of course, if you vomit, the earlier the vomit, the higher your dose and potentially the more severe your disease. Mm-hmm. However, remember that vomiting is not always a reliable manifestation. Mm-hmm. Some people have the ability to not to vomit. They have a strong stomach, as they would say, or others may vomit because someone else is vomiting, yeah. Which brings us into psychogenic vomiting. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, it's not a foolproof manifestation. Mm-hmm. However, it's useful for the medical provider to look at this. Mm-hmm. And I would basically look at the patient and ask them if they've had any vomiting, any nausea, mm-hmm. did they have any headache, did they have any loss of consciousness, that's a really bad sign. Mm-hmm. Diarrhea within the first hour is also a bad sign. Mm-hmm. So I think gathering this information is important mm-hmm. in addition to the history. Where were you at the time of the accident? Mm-hmm. You know, if you are, 1,000 miles away and you vomited, that doesn't mean you have a significant radiation exposure.
Right.
The medical provider will need to rely on additional tests, mm-hmm. More objective tests. And I would add to that at that point, blood tests. Mm-hmm. As I said before, the radioactive material emitting the radiation can kill cells. We mentioned that earlier on. Mm-hmm. When you kill cells that are what we call stem cells or cells that produce other lineages of cells, then you may develop a drop in the count of these cells. Mm-hmm. For example, if you kill the stem cells in the bone marrow, then you may see a drop in the white counts, the white blood cell counts, mm-hmm. the red blood cell counts as well. And the white blood cell count is composed of different cells as well. The first one you would see is the lymphocyte. Mm-hmm. And this is why it's important for the medical provider to look at the lymphocyte count drop. Actually, you're able to measure the absolute lymphocyte count, obtain serial measurements over the first 24 hours or 48 hours, and plot them and see if they're dropping. Mm-hmm. The REM website, REMM website, mm-hmm. that I mentioned earlier, has a useful calculator in which you can actually enter your absolute lymphocyte counts, and you can enter the time that blood draw was obtained relative to the exposure, and it will give you an estimate mm-hmm. of the radiation dose mm-hmm. that was involved there. They actually also have a calculator for vomiting, time of vomiting, and you can enter that and gives you an estimate. It's a very useful website. Mm-hmm. It's a free website to access. It is, contains algorithms, fact sheets, and these useful calculators.
Okay. Very good.
Now, once you establish that the patient is going to develop one of these sub-syndromes, mostly the bone marrow syndrome, where you want to really focus all your intensive care, then the care is quite complex. And here you need to think about supportive care, of course, the anti-emetics, the IV fluids, the blood products, but the intensive care comes in with your antimicrobials, including your antibacterials, antifungals, antivirals. Mm-hmm. You can think about administering a drug that is available in the strategic national stockpile called filgrastim, mm-hmm. which will hasten the recovery of your bone marrow, mm-hmm. hasten the recovery of these injured stem cells. Mm-hmm. And potentially, if the injury is severe enough, you can reach out to the Radiation Injury Treatment Network and work with them on transplants, stem cell transplants for these severely injured or exposed victims. Okay. Again, to put this back in context, primarily inside the nuclear power plant, mm-hmm. not an issue in the surrounding communities.
Sure.
In a nuclear power plant accident scenario.
Sure. Now, you mentioned 24 to 48 hours as far as some of these different symptoms are concerned, and we were talking about the vomiting a little bit ago, and you know, the earlier you vomit, the worse it is. Is there a window where that kind of ends? You know, like say I vomit 12 hours later, am I still at high risk, or am I?
I think at that point you start losing the benefit from this prodromal mm-hmm. symptom of vomiting specifically. Mm-hmm. The area that I'm really mostly interested in is the 4 hours area.
Okay.
Where if you vomit within 4 hours, mm-hmm. then we're concerned that you may have a significant exposure that you're gonna actually potentially have a disease.
Okay. So 4 hours is a good time frame. Okay.
Now, there are additional tests, of course, that I didn't really mention.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
There's an additional test where you can look at the chromosomes mm-hmm. and see if they're damaged.
Mm-hmm.
That test is performed in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, uh-huh. at REACTS lab, mm-hmm. and will take several days to get a result, but it's a very accurate way to determine the dose of exposure from external mm-hmm. radiation. They are working now on ways to make this test more automated to get the results faster and mm-hmm. do more blood samples at the same time.
Okay. So, Bob, now that we know all of the things that can go wrong with us if we're exposed to radioactive material during a nuclear power plant accident, what can people do to protect themselves? Mostly, I guess, the public here, because they're probably the ones who are less informed than those working in the power plant. So what can the public do to protect themselves from cancers, other things going wrong with them?
Well, there are three major radiation protection principles that your radiation control program in your state or your locality, in addition to your public health, uses to protect both workers and the public from radiation. Those three things are time, distance, and shielding. And we think about time, and when we use that is reducing the amount of time you're exposed to a radioactive source. Mm-hmm. As Dr. Kazi already mentioned, the workers' time going into those areas trying to keep the plant operating were limited, so they were given a certain amount of time with a stopwatch, someone watching them going in to do certain things, opening, closing valves and such, mm-hmm. trying to protect the plant, keeping releases low. Mm-hmm. Another arm of that protection is distance, mm-hmm. distancing ourselves from radioactive materials. So putting more distance between us and that source. Mm-hmm. And let me throw in an analogy. It's just like a fireplace. The closer you are to a fireplace, the hotter it feels. Mm-hmm. The further you're away, the less of the heat you feel. Mm-hmm. Same kind of thing with a radiation source. If that source of fire were happen to be a radioactive source, the further away you move, mm-hmm. which in some cases isn't a very long distance, even a few feet can reduce significantly the radiation exposure a person may receive. Mm-hmm. The third leg of that radiation protection principles is shielding, and that basically is putting something between us and the source of radiation so that we limit or reduce the amount of exposure. A typical example is when you go get a dental x-ray in practice, you're usually draped in a lead apron. Well, that's a shielding mechanism, prevent any scattered radiation from what comes from your teeth back down into the body. Another important thing that I think Dr. Kazi mentioned was how more sensitive children and women are to thyroid disease, and a lot of your dentists and a lot of the radiologists now have thyroid shields. When you go in for that radiation procedure, they'll actually protect your thyroid. So shielding is one of those mm-hmm. things we use to protect the populations. If we look at that on a global scale from a nuclear power plant situation, we have two emergency planning zones that those three protective measures are used for populations. We have a 10-mile emergency planning zone and a 50-mile emergency planning zone. The difference in those is primarily looking at the emergency in the 10-mile emergency planning zone. Mm-hmm. We're primarily concerned about external exposure and iodine protection in that 10-mile ring, where those protective measures of moving people out, mm-hmm. evacuating, mm-hmm. or sheltering them if we can't get them out soon enough. Many of these protective measures can be used prior to a release even occurring. If we start looking at plant conditions in a particular locale where the plant systems are degrading to the point where a release might occur, evacuation could be implemented before a plume or a airborne release happens. And basically, the graphic on your screen shows this keyhole approach, mm-hmm. that's normally considered. You have this small radius around the nuclear power plant where evacuation is implemented, but also this keyhole out from that center, mm-hmm. is using modeling. Each power plant has a meteorological tower, mm-hmm. which indicates the wind at different elevations, so you can kind of get a feel on where the plume may go. And so we usually use this keyhole effect to look at not only a radius around the plant, but distances downwind, mm-hmm. that might become affected. So if you start getting people out, moving them away from that center line, mm-hmm. of pathway, you can actually reduce or remove them from that potential hazard of being exposed. So evacuation is typically used, as it was in Fukushima. We've had several cities being evacuated. Those folks that were evacuated have to have some place to go. So the best place is usually gymnasiums, mm-hmm. arenas of that like. All the nuclear power stations have designated relocation centers or evacuation centers where folks may go, and this is where people can seek shelter, mm-hmm. you know, get the adequate basic needs, food, water, shelter, mm-hmm. While they're waiting either to return if the release never happens, or perhaps some type of relocation downwind.
I want to get to these shelters and how effective they are when an evacuation happens, but I want to ask you, for the folks who live in these emergency planning zones, these cities, these towns, whatever the case may be, how closely are they working either with CDC or other local health officials on their evacuation plan? Because obviously a nuclear power plant accident is not something that we have every day or often. It's not like we can prepare like a hurricane or a tornado. It's not something we do a lot. So how well prepared are these folks in these emergency planning zones on what to do if something were to happen at a nuclear power plant?
Well, let me first say that, you know, they don't hear from CDC when it deals with nuclear power plant, mm-hmm. situations. The most they deal with is with the radiation control programs within their state or their public health agency within their states. Those folks that live within the 10-mile emergency planning zone, they know they're there because they get indication, they get awareness, they get mailings directly from the planners around those facilities, mm-hmm. so that they're made aware of what protective measures are in place for them, where they might go should an evacuation order be given, mm-hmm. and whether or not KI is recommended as a supplement should, mm-hmm. evacuation or sheltering not be feasible.
Okay.
So working with the state rad control program or the state public, sure. health agency who's involved with that planning and preparedness, they're pretty well aware, okay. of that. And even folks within the 50 mile, mm-hmm. they know, you know, they're within an area too, right. where other protective measures may take place. We talked earlier about the 10-mile emergency planning zone being one in which evacuation or sheltering may take place. The 50-mile is what we consider an ingestion pathway zone. And if we go back to those pathways of exposure we talked about earlier, that's where we worry about interdicting crops, perhaps, mm-hmm. if the material was released atmospherically, mm-hmm. ended up falling onto the ground or onto plants or onto vegetation. We might interdict cattle, take cattle off of the pasture, putting them on stored feed so they get a pristine food source, so, mm-hmm. that the milk doesn't become contaminated. Those are the type of protective measures that are in place around for the 50-mile emergency, sure. planning zone.
Basically, if you're in a zone, you know it, and you're aware of what to do in case of an emergency.
Yes.
Okay. So let's talk about what happens then in an emergency. You mentioned shelters. How effective are shelters? I think I've seen some schools in your pictures and maybe what looks like a big gymnasium. How effective is that in keeping people safe from exposure?
Well, pretty much they're safe to a point. It's, mm-hmm. not like folks can shelter in place forever. But we do have some very good work that's been done looking at other scenarios of radiation exposure where you might look at sheltering as an option should you not be able to get someone out soon enough. But if you were to look at the image on your screen, we have some various building structures. Mm-hmm. Now, a one-story wood frame home doesn't provide as much shelter as a huge concrete courthouse building in your area that has a fallout shelter. But basically, if you look at these different color-coded rooms, what you get is a sense of the most protection in the light blue. And what we're talking about here is protection factors greater than 200. Mm-hmm. Let me explain that a little bit. Mm-hmm. It would be a good example of that is if you stood out in the open field with no building structures around you, and you were to stand there for 1 hour, that would be in a radiation field that would give you, let's say, 5, mm-hmm. just as an example. Mm-hmm. You could stay in a basement structure in those light blue areas 200 hours before you'd see that 5. Mm-hmm. So basically you're getting 200 times more protection in that lower level interior, and as you can see even in the upper structures in the high-rise buildings, staying away from exterior windows and walls, move to interior building, and down low is the place to go.
Right, down low and interior. I notice in this large apartment building, in this particular graphic that you have up, there's one rectangle, kind of 1, 2, 3, 4 rectangles up from the bottom and in the fourth row. It's right there in the middle. It's 100, and everything. Well, the one above it is 30. What is the major difference between a floor? Is it just up higher? The exposure is a little greater? Obviously, I know it's the center of the building, so it's safer. But yeah. Talk a little bit about why.
The reason why some of those is basically the modeling they've done. Mm-hmm. They look at several factors. They look at how much material could be brought into a building. For example, if some folks were in cars driving to an area and a plume came over and they were told to evacuate, don't stay in the car. Seek shelter inside of a very firm structural building with heavier than wood side walls, most likely brick and mortar. Those folks are likely, if they were driving through, could be contaminating those lower levels. So that would provide another source of exposure. Plus, the roof is a collector for material that fell from the sky, and it would be an area where you wouldn't want to stay at the very top where the roof is. You'd want to get down in the central part. So you'll see a higher protection on those middle levels.
Okay, makes sense. Now, Kazi, I know we just mentioned the potassium iodide, and I remember with the Japan incident, how a lot of folks here in the U.S. kind of rushed out, to get this potassium iodide to protect themselves. Was that necessary? Did it work? And are we there yet in our presentation? Or maybe you're
we
gonna
are.
About
well,
okay.
You know, well, the short answer is no, it was not necessary. Mm-hmm. And potentially harmful to ingest potassium iodide if you don't need to. The what I wanted to just highlight in the screenshot right now is that public health authorities, your radiation control program, will understand the type of exposure that's at risk here and the dose that people are at risk for. And based on that, they will make these decisions of evacuation, sheltering, or even administering potassium iodide or not. Mm-hmm. So this is based on information that's from the field and work from experts in this area to make a recommendation for public health, for a public health action of giving potassium iodide distributing it to people, administering it.
Okay.
We did not have the need to do that in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
We were not even close to that. So this was not an issue here. I think this was driven by fear and probably, unfortunately, by maybe a misunderstanding of the role of potassium iodide.
Mm-hmm.
Potassium iodide is not a magic bullet. Potassium iodide protects you from radioactive iodine if you take it before or shortly, very shortly after the exposure. And, of course, that leads to challenges of where you stockpile potassium iodide close enough to people to take it in time.
Mm-hmm.
And those are all things that states deal with on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
But in the Japan incident. Even in Japan, there was even though there were some people that some local authorities recommended giving potassium iodide to the public, it didn't end up being distributed to the public.
Okay.
And potassium iodide is going to act in the thyroid gland the same way as radioactive iodine would.
Mm-hmm.
It would be uptaken by the thyroid gland. The good news is that it's not radioactive. So the goal of this therapy is to saturate the thyroid gland. Mm-hmm. As I said, if you are iodine deficient or if you are a child, your thyroid gland is going to be hungry for iodine. If it sees radioactive iodine or non-radioactive iodine, it's going to take it up mm-hmm. and try to make thyroid hormone. Mm-hmm. If you get that potassium iodide in the gland, well comfortable in that inside that structure before the radioactive iodine comes in, mm-hmm. then you're in good shape. The radioactive iodine will come into the system, you inhale it, goes into circulation, shows up to the thyroid gland, and finds it saturated. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the gland saying to the radioactive iodine, thank you, we're full. Mm-hmm. So the radioactive iodine will have no place to go except leaving your body in the urine. Again, the challenge there, though, is to be there before the radioactive iodine, which can be inhaled in certain situations and which is a rapid absorption mm-hmm. Into your body. The potassium iodide pill that people take will saturate your thyroid gland for a 24-hour period. Mm-hmm. So if you've taken it without the appropriate recommendation, and then, let's say, a day later, the recommendation is issued, mm-hmm. you're not protected anymore.
Right.
You have to take another dose. Mm-hmm. And taking more than one dose, especially if you're pregnant or if you're an infant, is not safe because blocking the thyroid gland with the potassium iodide mm-hmm. also has consequences on your thyroid function. Mm-hmm. So blocking it for several days, your thyroid function may decline as well.
Okay.
And thyroid hormones are very important for mental development, especially in infants or even in the fetus mm-hmm. Of a pregnant woman who's taken several doses of potassium iodide. So it's very important to always link your use of potassium iodide to appropriate, sound recommendation from your local or state public health authorities that know what they're doing. The dose also of potassium iodide varies by age. As I said, children are the most vulnerable, so really someone as old as Bob, again, picking on him, probably does not need potassium iodide. Mm-hmm. The benefit from potassium iodide in someone who's older than 40 years of age does not justify the risk of taking it on your thyroid function. Okay. Say you have thyroid disease that hasn't been diagnosed, you have a nodule that hasn't been diagnosed, it may get you in trouble. And the risk of cancer in someone who's older than 4 years from that radioactive iodine exposure does not justify taking that medicine. Mm-hmm. That's why you see the U.S. Food and Drug Administration has guidelines on different doses of potassium iodide based on the age. And you see that primarily in different projected doses of radiation exposure mm-hmm. from the radioactive iodine. So the people that will probably get that drug first, these are going to be your children under 18 years of age and your pregnant woman. Mm-hmm. And if you're an infant, your dose is going to be much less than if you are an 18-year-old person. Mm-hmm. So that's very important to keep in mind when considering potassium iodide. People ran around buying potassium iodide, and the main FDA-approved preparations ran out of stock. Mm-hmm. And without any justification, in my opinion.
Wow. Okay.
And I also mentioned, and I want to highlight one more thing about potassium iodide, the need to take it shortly after the potential for exposure. Mm-hmm. Because as time goes by, the efficacy is going to decrease, and potentially if you take it long after the exposure, will be counterproductive and actually increase your exposure to radiation. If you take it, let's say, 12 hours later after you've already incorporated the radioactive material in your thyroid gland.
Okay. So the widespread panic here, not really necessary.
Not necessary.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What about in kids, in children?
In kids, mm-hmm. Even though they are more vulnerable, mm-hmm. the doses that were projected in the U.S. were not a risk for children. Mm-hmm. Now, fortunately for us, we do have potassium iodide mm-hmm. that is liquid, easy for children to ingest. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have the liquid formulation, you can actually crush the tablets and prepare them. There's some guidance on our CDC website as well as the FDA website mm-hmm. explaining to the public how to crush the tablets and put them into an appropriate solution
right.
to be used by children that cannot swallow tablets.
Mm-hmm. And we may be getting into this point a little bit later, too, but potassium iodide, I mean, is it readily available? Is it only available in certain places? Can I go to the drugstore and buy it over the counter? How do people get a hold of it?
Potassium iodide currently in the U.S. Mm-hmm. Is approved by the FDA in three different formulations that are available over the
right.
counter.
Okay.
And but as I said, the stockpiles ran out.
Stockpile, okay. So we do have it stockpiled. I know the Strategic National Stockpile, does it have quantities of...
The Strategic National Stockpile currently has a small quantity of liquid KI formulation
mm-hmm.
that is actually about to expire. There's discussion on replenishing that stockpile that I don't think is final yet.
Okay.
But usually you can find potassium iodide stockpiled in some states that mm-hmm. want to use it, different states in the U.S., mm-hmm. and others prefer to use other protective action measures like evacuation or sheltering in place.
Okay.
And may even have potassium iodide reserved for emergency workers, for example.
Okay. Very good. So, Bob, coming back around to you now, how do people know that they're going to be okay? Despite, you know, I mean, we saw a lot of people panic here last year when the Japan incident happened, and they were fine. So how do people know that they're going to be okay? Are there things they can do? Obviously, folks who are much closer to an accident site need to be a lot more aware. So what can they do to make sure that they're okay, and despite what fears they may have, to kind of calm down a little bit and maybe just breathe a little?
Yeah. Well, that's one thing we've thought a lot about at CDC, and one of the primary roles that we had been put in as far as a national response framework dealing with radiation or other nuclear matters was in the area of what we call population monitoring.
Mm-hmm.
Population monitoring is an umbrella type of under which a variety of activities take place. We want to assess the population for parameters, and this may take place separate from evacuation centers. It may be at the evacuation centers, but we talked about these as community reception centers that mm-hmm. after, quote, the dust settles on an incident,
mm-hmm.
how might we assess the situation, assess the population in these different centers for indicators of external contamination,
mm-hmm.
Who's contaminated, who's exposed,
mm-hmm.
who requires treatment if they have been, decontamination, and then also assessment of their dose
mm-hmm.
and potential for health risk.
Mm-hmm.
If we look at the long-term monitoring, we when people come into these community reception centers, they're looking for information, they're looking for counseling, am I at risk?
Right.
You know, so they have a lot of questions that need to be answered. So it's going to take a huge number of people to process them. When folks first come in, we want to look at monitoring.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we need people there to handle either monitoring stations, handle the crisis counseling stations. There's a lot of non-government organizations that come to play here, mm-hmm. like the Red Cross and others who actually participate in a number of the exercises and drills that the nuclear power stations conduct.
Mm-hmm.
But then once we do all these contamination identification, exposure assessments, long-term registries may come into play as they are now coming into play in Fukushima. They are conducting what is now the Japanese Health Administration is looking at a 30-year study of approximately 2 million people that evacuated and were potentially exposed in Fukushima. That's a huge effort. Even though the doses were low, it's really looking at providing comfort, providing some kind of assurance, providing some answers that they may not otherwise have gotten.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a huge effort in population monitoring, as we saw played out in the local news media, with a number of folks with radiation detection equipment looking at children, looking at pets, primarily before they even went into the relocation centers or community reception centers.
Mm-hmm.
So what you'll see in these is a variety of methods used to detect contamination on a person. If you were to walk into a situation, you don't want to contaminate your community reception center, so you would like to monitor them before they came in fully.
Mm-hmm.
We can do that, and our state and local partners do that with portal monitors, which is basically a frame structure that you walk through like you do going through the TSA screening at airports. But this is not looking for metal on a person. It's looking for contamination. We can also use handheld devices, which are very sensitive, to look for contamination on an individual. So there are a number of screenshots we have here that show you some typical operations that can occur with those types of detection capabilities. Mm-hmm. Here's a community reception center, for example. It could be a local gymnasium, mm-hmm. an arena, a National Guard armory. It could be a number of facilities, either pre-designated or some that can be designated on the fly if you need them.
Right.
So standard precautions for workers in these facilities, similar to the same dress that you would use for any medical institution, mm-hmm. gloves, booties, aprons, and mask. Here's some portal monitors that can be used. As you can see, you can also use those for those physically challenged that can come in that need those extra assistance. And so we have a variety of very sensitive monitoring capabilities to help assess external contamination. Once that person is found to be externally contaminated, mm-hmm. some decontamination may be required.
Sure.
So your facility would have or should have some type of showering facilities.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're concerned about primarily, and as was played out in Fukushima, you look for exposed areas of the skin, the hands, the feet, the face, the head, the hair. This hair especially are very good collectors of dust, as we know, but they're also very good collectors of radioactive materials. So those are areas we'd examine first and then look at other parts of the body.
Mm-hmm.
And then once they're cleaned up or once they're found to be contaminated and once they're sent to showers, if found to be contaminated and then cleaned up with just basic soap and water, primarily not heavy scrubbing, it's not always necessary.
Mm-hmm.
Radioactive materials are just like any other hygiene practice, can normally, typically be removed easily with that.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, once we determine that they're externally decontaminated, they may come back again for some more monitoring to see if there's any residual radioactivity left.
Mm-hmm.
If they've been externally cleaned and you still detect something, it may be an internal contamination issue, which could be taken care of with some radiological countermeasures.
Okay. And Kazi, you being the medical doctor here, the internal detection, more blood tests, what kind of things would that entail if folks came back to find out if they had more exposure internally?
Well, ideally, if you know that they have a risk of being internally contaminated,
mm-hmm.
it'd be nice to actually address that in that visit to the community reception center, and
mm-hmm.
after they are decontaminated,
mm-hmm.
If they were externally, covered, let's say, with radioactive material, then you can actually ask that question and try to determine that. It's not very easy to do that. It's going to rely on measuring radioactive material in the urine,
mm-hmm.
whether you do that by a 24-hour urine collection or by a single urine sample. That's an option,
mm-hmm.
Whether you actually use some radiation detectors that try to measure radioactive material inside the body, emitting radiation outside the body,
mm-hmm.
like specifically material that emit gamma rays. So you may look at some of these detectors.
Mm-hmm.
Once you determine that, you add to that an exposure assessment. You look for these other signs and symptoms we talked about.
Uh-huh.
If you're concerned about exposure to significant amount of radiation, which is probably not going to be the case in a nuclear power plant accident and the public health in the surrounding community,
mm-hmm.
but let's say you are asking that question, then you could measure absolute lymphocyte counts, look at the vomiting,
mm-hmm.
Maybe even send blood to Oak Ridge for the chromosome analysis.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do feel that there's a need for a countermeasure or medication to be administered,
mm-hmm.
then this is where you probably start, by considering that in a nuclear power plant accident, the drug, which is potassium iodide for radioactive iodine, at that moment, it's probably too late to give it.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably something that you could have considered initially.
Wow.
But if you, let's say, want to give a countermeasure for cesium, then you can give Prussian blue.
Mm-hmm.
And another radiological accident or incident that involve other radioactive materials like plutonium or americium,
mm-hmm.
you may give calcium or zinc DTPA.
Okay.
But essentially, that is the conclusion of your visit to the CRC.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to the mental health evaluation,
mm-hmm.
you can talk to the patient and discuss with them how they're feeling and try to screen them for signs of mental health distress.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a great opportunity there to perform your psychological first aid,
mm-hmm.
and refer them appropriately if they need to, as well as what Bob mentioned about enrolling them in a health registry or getting their contact information so that you can communicate with them later on, as well as follow them for long-term effects that may occur.
Okay, very good. Let's go back to for a second to the external decontamination. We saw a lot of pictures of people, you know, kind of getting screened, the process in those community centers, the machines and stuff. So if somebody is found to have contamination on their clothes or their hair, you mentioned, you know, soap and water, pretty good to remove some of this radiation. I would assume clothes, shoes, that kind of stuff, if it's detected on that, gets thrown away. How does that work if it's not something, you know, or can you wash it and it'll be fine since the soap and water, you said, works?
Yeah. Well, as I said earlier, any exposed part of a person can be a collector of contamination, and that's when we worry about it being on the person.
Okay.
We do know it also is contaminated if it's on the clothes. I mean, perhaps someone at spring break would probably be more contaminated on their skin than they would be if they were in winter time with jackets on, et cetera. So the more exposed parts of your body, the more likely you can get contamination on the skin. Knowing that the clothes are contaminated, the most likely scenario is you come into these facilities, if you are found to be contaminated with this external monitoring that takes place, your clothes can be removed, bagged, tagged, and then perhaps saved later for clothes cleaning and other type activities. But that requires then that you need to have some supplemental clothes available at your community reception centers for those folks when they have to disrobe and then go to showering and then have something to put on when they come back. So very good question. It's one thing that we struggle with because personal items, then again, away from the person, you're going to put them in a more compromised position where the mental health issues are going to be more pronounced. For example, do I get rid of my wallet or my purse or my watch that my granddad gave me? You know, all those things come into play then. How do you handle them? And you need to be prepared at the community reception center.
Right. And can I take it one step further for those folks who live in those close radiuses to nuclear power plants? What about their homes? I mean, we saw the graphic earlier, you know, the sheltering in place. You know, some of these homes, if they're just little one-story houses, they obviously don't provide much shelter from exposure. So what about the things inside the home, the furniture, the clothes in there, the, or are they okay because it's not skin contact, but I would imagine there's some kind of exposure, right? Or am I...
It really depends on the home. And any building, you're going to have some air infiltration coming in either through the chimney, through the windows, through other cracks and seals. But, you know, most homes these days that we've tried to make energy efficient, we've actually sealed up better. So that's a good thing to keep heat in. It's also another good thing to keep things outside from getting in. So we would expect that most material inside the home would be less than outside.
Okay.
Can't always guarantee that, but it's definitely one of those long-term concerns that get into other environmental aspects on not just people being contaminated, but property.
Okay, very good. I want to take a minute now to remind folks out there watching that you can call or you can email us if you have any questions for our panelists. We'll still be here for a little bit longer, so take advantage of them being here. I also want to look to our audience members. Do any of you have any questions or anything for our panelists at the moment? No? No email questions right now. Okay, so we'll be here for a few more minutes, so don't be shy. We'd love to talk to you. If you do have a question or an email, feel free to call us. We'll be happy to answer your questions. We mentioned some of the ways, you know, the potassium iodide to kind of help maybe offset some of the symptoms if you take it within the right amount of time, the right dose, that kind of thing. We also mentioned that those supplies ran out. Is there another measure, another way to help protect yourself in that kind of a situation if there is no more potassium iodide and that's what you need to kind of offset the exposure? Is there something else that can be used in place of that?
Do you mean like other type of drugs?
Yes, anything. Any iodide-containing things or any drugs?
That's a great question.
Anything?
We actually, during our duty hours at the Emergency Operations Center at CDC, we had to answer some of these questions. One question I remember that came up was about using iodized salt to protect oneself from the radioiodine effect on the thyroid gland. And that's not going to protect you, even though it does contain the similar composition, mm-hmm. you probably need several pounds of salt, and you probably suffer from salt toxicity mm-hmm. before you can actually effectively block your thyroid gland. There are also numerous internet web portals trying to sell iodine-containing preparations that are not FDA approved, mm-hmm. and that's also concerning because the dose of you know iodide in there is not clear. The absorption, mm-hmm. the efficacy of that drug in blocking your thyroid gland is mm-hmm. unknown. The side effect profile. Some of these substances can contain as well as other components that can be toxic to you. So certainly should not be used in a nuclear power plant accident. This makes me reemphasize again mm-hmm. the need to follow your local and state public health authorities' recommendations mm-hmm. and use your U.S. FDA-approved preparations. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the other methods or alternative therapies would not be recommended. I think they're potentially unsafe and also potentially non-efficacious.
Okay, very good. We do have a phone call that has come in for the both of you, so let's go ahead and take that phone call now from Washington, D.C. Hello, caller.
Hi, yes. My name is Nicole Whitaker, and I just have a question about the emergency planning zones. Mm-hmm. So I actually live within a 50-mile emergency planning zone, and I have never actually gotten any kind of material or notification or anything from the power plant nearby. So I was just wondering if there's a clearinghouse of the type of information that you were talking about that we could look at, or if it's something where I'd have to contact the spokesperson for the plant, or how that works.
That's a great question. I think.
well, thank you. I'll try to field that one first. When we were talking about the emergency planning zones, the 10-mile primarily being the emergency planning zone is the area where most of the residents are very well aware of the nuclear power plant planning that goes on, whereby there are numerous exercises that are conducted every year and testing of emergency communication systems and alert systems to let them know about those plant exercises. I believe if it's still in place, every year they have to conduct a 10-mile emergency planning zone exercise. For the 50-mile zone, I think it's every 6 years. So it's not as frequent in your 50-mile area as it is in the 10-mile area. So that's another one of these factors that comes into play.
Okay.
Folks within the 10-mile are very much more aware.
More aware, because obviously they're closer. Their risk is greater. So. Caller, I don't know if you're still there. Did that help a little bit? Are there any other places she can turn to that she can maybe get some resources? Would she need to call the plant, call her local health department, health, whatever, in D.C.? Or
yeah, I would look to your RAD control program in mm-hmm. your area primarily because they are probably most readily involved with those emergency power plant mm-hmm. exercises that are conducted. Some of those RAD control programs are within the health department, mm-hmm. perhaps in your jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. Others may be outside, maybe in an environmental department within the state agency. Mm-hmm. But that would be a good place to start because that's where the planning, they have the plans and mm-hmm. they have the procedures in place for dealing with a nuclear power plant scenario.
Okay. Very good. We have some Alabama. Oh, thank you. Sorry. Did that help?
Yes, it does. Thank you so much for answering.
No, thank you for your call.
Sure. Bye-bye.
Some of our Alabama folks here in the audience, and I know it's different from state to state, but similar procedures here in Alabama as far as our nuclear power plants are concerned. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Our next major exercise is on May the 9th. It's mm-hmm. down in the Farley plant in Dothan, Houston County, and our most exercise before that was at the Browns Ferry. It was back this past December. Mm-hmm. The 10-mile zone is primarily aimed at the residents. Mm-hmm. The 50-mile zone is aimed at the ingestion pathway, the crops and the farmers, mm-hmm. and the way in which food items were produced in that area would be tested before they're taken to market. Now, this past December, we did the both the evacuation zone, the 10-mile exercise, as well as we did an exercise in conjunction with the Department of Agriculture with all the food crops in within the 50-mile pathway.
Okay, very good. Thank you for that information. I know we have an email question.
We have a couple of them.
Okay, great.
We'll start and work way down here.
Okay.
Atmospheric conditions know no boundaries. Can you discuss lessons learned from states and countries working together to track fallout from Three Mile, Chernobyl, or the most recent incident in Japan?
Well, I guess that one's for me, too. I think we've relearned a lot, and I'll say that because what happened at Three Mile Island versus Chernobyl were extremely two different things. At Three Mile Island, the releases were very minuscule, not a whole lot of radioactive material released from Three Mile Island. Compare and contrast that with Chernobyl, where huge, significant quantities of radioactive material were released, subsequently transported throughout the environment globally, where we saw iodines and cesium being transported across the globe. On a similar fashion, back to Fukushima, even though it was not as severe as far as the amount of radioactive material releases from Chernobyl, our detection capabilities across the states in the U.S. were such that they were so sensitive that they picked up such minuscule amounts of radioactive iodine and cesium. What we've learned is, again, this material can move far and wide. The good news is, as we talked about earlier in the radiation protection principles, the time, distance, and shielding, distance came into play here again in Fukushima, that we're 6,000 or so miles, at least the west coast of the U.S. is 6,000 or so miles from Japan. And as the material moved across the Pacific, it diminished both from radioactive decay, from removal as it fell out from the cloud as it moved across. So we were protected in that the further away we were, the less we had to worry about it. However, our detection capability is very sensitive in the U.S. We found it in water, we found it in rain, we found it in milk, but at very low levels, levels that weren't warranted as far as interdiction any food source. It didn't warrant people taking potassium iodide, nor did it warrant any other protective measures, like taking cows off of, you know, stored or off of pasture, putting them on stored feed. So that's the good news. I think we relearned some lessons because, again, as we know, a lot of the protective action decision making that has to go on occurs at very high levels. Mm-hmm. And we, as the RAD control program within a state or the public health department or CDC for that matter, we're having to provide information to folks who have never experienced or don't know what we know or have learned about Chernobyl or Fukushima again. So we have to advise them very carefully so that they can make the right choices and the right decisions to protect their communities.
Excellent. Here's our next email question for you. What is the risk of secondary exposure to healthcare workers? For example, those patients with acute illnesses presenting to emergency rooms with vomiting and diarrhea, how should they be managed? Doctor, I think that's your question.
Well, that's a great question. And a patient coming into the emergency department with vomiting, assumingly from exposure to radiation, is not necessarily contaminated. That's the first thing to remember. And if someone is not contaminated and was exposed to radiation, they do not pose any risk to their surrounding. Think of it as a patient that undergoes a chest x-ray in your emergency department and comes out of the radiology department, comes back to their room. They are not treated differently. They are not treated as contaminated. Mm-hmm. Now, let's assume that this patient was actually contaminated. In that specific situation as well, the hazard to the surrounding is also minimal and not significant. And this is actually proven in a couple of cases, one in Goiânia, where the healthcare workers cared for several individuals that were contaminated with cesium that was radioactive, and none of these healthcare workers developed any significant radiation exposure or contamination. Even a better example was in London, where there were about 28 workers, healthcare workers, who took care of the deceased Mr. Alessandro Litinienko, and they did not actually know that he was contaminated with radioactive polonium till when he died. And all through that period, which is about 2 to 3 weeks, they cared for that patient using standard precautions and did not get any significant contamination as they were actually tested after the incident was discovered. it's important to keep your distance, decrease your time in these situations if you know the patient is heavily contaminated. These scenarios are not going to be seen frequently. It requires a lot of contamination on your body or inside your body to pose such a hazard. An important lesson that we, or an important message that REACTS, as well as CDC, always tries to emphasize is that the care of a critically injured victim that happens to also be contaminated with radioactive material should not be postponed until decontamination is performed. This is not a patient that is contaminated with a highly toxic chemical that can injure or kill the healthcare workers shortly after they get contaminated by it or get exposed to it. I hope that answered that question.
Excellent. If not, I'm sure she'll email back. We have another one here. What was the role of U.S. poison centers during the Japan crisis?
That's probably for me. Since I'm a medical toxicologist, I'll go ahead and field that question. The U.S. poison control centers were part of the response. They actually received numerous calls from concerned individuals. They answered these questions as well as answered questions about potassium iodide. Some people were calling about that. It was a very important partner for the response, and their resources were actually very useful to us. The other organization that received a lot of calls was REACTS as well, received hundreds of calls from concerned individuals asking different type of questions.
Excellent. We have one more, I do believe. You said to remove clothes is if they were contaminated. Can the exposed body parts be washed to get rid of radiation? I think you've answered that we could do that to be safe. Exposed hair in the area, what do we do with the hair? Just wash soap and water. I think same thing.
Well, that brings up an interesting story. As Fukushima was unfolding, one of the things that CDC did, which was related to this population monitoring aspect, was work with the Customs and Border Protection, which actually monitor passengers every day coming back in the U.S. from other countries as typical Homeland Security requirements. But during Fukushima, there was a question and concern about passengers potentially coming back from Japan with contamination on them in the planes and then arriving here in the U.S. It turns out there were a few individuals that were picked up with some contamination on them in the Fukushima event coming back from Japan. One of the individuals happened to be a male with a beard, and the contamination just happened to be contained in his beard. He did shower several times to remove that some of that contamination, but from what we gather, upon his mother's request, he shaved his beard just to completely remove that source.
So. Okay.
Interesting.
Then just throw the clippings away and you're good, right? Any other emails?
Right.
Okay. We've mentioned a lot about, you know, people, and we've talked briefly about some of the different animals, grass that can also be contaminated, water sources from nuclear power plant accidents. So in that case, you know, we've got contamination, a cow eats grass, the cow goes to slaughter, we get some hamburgers, and then we eat contaminated burgers. I mean, does that happen? Canned food, water, milk, those kind of things get contaminated? Would they be safe to consume in a situation like that?
Well, in fact, that did play out in Fukushima. As mm-hmm. we've seen, there's been many food restrictions put in place. In fact, the Japanese just lowered their contamination level in foods. For some time, the international community, when they were looking at cesium, they had some levels set about contamination, and pretty much activity or radioactivity per becquerel per kilogram of food. Mm-hmm. And so those levels were set at about 1,000 for international, for cesium-137. Mm-hmm. Japan lowered those many times during this course. They just lowered it again. Mm-hmm. It first went from 1,000 down to 500, mm-hmm. and now it's down to 100, okay. which is becquerels per kilogram. Mm-hmm. And a becquerel is nothing more than a disintegration per second. So if you were to take a beef sample mm-hmm. or a rice sample and you found within it more than 100 becquerels per kilogram of cesium, it would be considered not safe. Mm-hmm. So they would remove that from consumption, remove it from commerce, and it did happen. It didn't happen in Fukushima. It happened with beef, happened with milk, some water sources, and also primarily with rice. Now, there's been some other indications about the liquid releases into the ocean, about it potentially affecting some of the seafood sources, and there have been some fishermen that are unwilling still to fish in those areas around Fukushima. So, again, those do play out and those do happen, mm-hmm. And as they did in Fukushima. So interdicting those is one thing. I think you mentioned animals other than food source animals. Mm-hmm. Let me mention pets for a second. Mm-hmm. In Fukushima, it was not just a concern for the people, but it was also a concern for their pets. Mm-hmm. And as many of us know, some of our pets are more dear to us than some of our loved ones. And so the idea of, well, do we allow pets with the owners into community reception centers? In Japan, they have done that. They have actually worked out a way of monitoring those pets, putting them in separate cages within the community reception centers that they set up. So anyway, you have to plan for those mm-hmm. conditions, and knowing that, as I said before, that our hair can be a collector, mm-hmm. well, imagine your pet. Do you want to shave your pet? Those kind of mm-hmm. critical issues, and again, mental health issues, because already the evacuated or relocated populations is under severe stress just from leaving their home, but then you take their pet into another area separate from you to be decontaminated and perhaps groomed. Right. How do you handle that?
Right.
Can I add one thing about the food?
Yes.
I just want to remind the public that, or the audience, that eating that contaminated hamburger would not, and these limits are set not to protect you from basically getting sick when you eat the hamburger. You will not get sick from eating a hamburger that is contaminated above that limit. Mm-hmm. This limit is set up looking at long-term effects. Again, the mm-hmm. stochastic effects like cancer, for mm-hmm. example. And you have to be eating that hamburger for a certain period of time. And there are many assumptions that go into this. So if you happen to like maybe eat a hamburger once, and then find out it was contaminated above that limit that is set up, mm-hmm. the territory limit, that doesn't mean you're going to get cancer. That doesn't mean you're going to get sick. Mm-hmm. And just want to make sure that people understood that.
You're mentioning hamburger,
true for milk,
but
and
true
water,
for milk, water,
and vegetables.
Okay, very good.
You have to drink actually a certain amount of water that's contaminated mm-hmm. for, I think, 2 years.
Oh, wow, okay.
To develop that increase in cancer risk that is considered to be the minimum cancer risk of acceptable.
Okay, very good. More questions?
Another email just came in.
Okay.
I've been reviewing the guidelines, but do not see any forms that we could use for population monitoring. Does the CDC have a set of standardized forms with guidelines that should be utilized by public health for population monitoring? If so, in which guidelines document are they located?
Very good question. Yes, we do have some guidance material for population monitoring resources, and I think they'll be included at the end of this presentation, but basically it's www.emergency.cdc.gov/radiation, and if you just want to search on population monitoring, you'll find the guidance document. You'll also find resources regarding community reception centers and some other programs that would help and aid and assist you in planning for these type of activities.
And we are showing now some additional resources. The Radiation Emergency Medical Management web portal that I already mentioned several times. Our website link for the CDC over there as well. And of course, last but not least, the Radiation Emergency Assistance Center training site web portal. Also has valuable materials and videos that you can watch about how to decontaminate and care for these contaminated victims. For more information, of course, you can you have a phone number there for the CDC information line that you can call us at any time. Mm-hmm. And if you want to send us an email for Bob or myself, you can use that email, and we'll be happy to respond to you promptly.
Okay, very good. Any other questions before we say goodbye? No? Good. Any final thoughts the two of you want to leave our viewers with before we say goodbye today?
Well, I want to say that as a medical professional, I want to remind my colleagues in the medical profession that we have a role to play, and it doesn't necessarily mean we have to perform surgeries or administer medications, many times we have to communicate, we have to reassure. And I think nuclear power plant accidents are very rare. Mm-hmm. Nuclear power plants are safe, and we just have to keep reminding ourselves with the issues at hand if an accident occurs, and just be good doctors, communicate, reassure, and then help people as best as we can.
The thing I would just close in saying is, when we're talking about planning, we've talked about planning a lot in this presentation, but planning is not an endpoint. Planning is a process. And if we can look back on yesterday and say today we are better prepared than we were, I think we've done a good job. And I hope this webcast has helped you and us and the others do that very same thing.
Very good. Well, we thank you both for your time and your information today. A lot of good stuff that you let folks know about today. So thank you very much, both
thank
of you.
You,
for being here. And for those of you watching, don't forget, we do have another program coming up that you may be interested in. It's coming up next Thursday, April 19th, from 12 to 1:30 p.m. Central Time. The title for that program will be called Disaster Preparedness, Are You Ready for Kids? You can visit the website on our screen for more information on that program, as well as other future programs. This does conclude our program for today. Thank you again for your time, and we do hope you have a great rest of the day. Take care.